families, welcome back to the My Miller Show. This is your host, My Miller. So today I have a super special guest today. And I brought him in today because, you know, have you ever thought about what you want to be when you grow up? That was one question our parents asked us when we were kids. And sometimes as an adult, you know, we always wonder, what else do we want to be when we grow up? And I brought in this guest today because he quit his career job to start something that was inspiring to him. And I wanted to have him share some more of how that journey started. And he is also the co-host of No Eggs Podcast. So I wanted to bring you guys in, introduce you to Peng.
Yes.
Hi, Peng.
Thank you for having me on, first of all. And yeah, it's amazing the work that you do here. Just like you said, I have my own show. But it's nothing like this. Coming here and seeing all these cameras and these lights, it's a little intimidating. So if I'm a little nervous, I apologize.
Oh, yeah. No, I mean, you have a great show, too, No Eggs Podcast, right?
Yes. Yeah.
I watched your episodes as well, just a couple of recent episodes you guys done. Amazing. You guys brought in great guests, and I love what you guys are doing over there as well.
Yeah, we're super fortunate, and, it's a Hmong... It's a podcast centered on Hmong men's health, and we primarily focus on like Hmong men's mental health. We've been having a lot of great discussions. I have a great co-host in Tulo. He's the owner of Yellow Auto Sport. It's a car detail shop in Little Canada. I have to make sure I shout him out too because I wouldn't be here without him. Yeah. And so he's shout out to him. He's doing amazing.
Shout out to shout out to Lauren and Lillian, right?
Yes. Yeah. Those are my two daughters. So I have two daughters. I'm married. I have my wife's name is Barbara. My oldest is 5. She's in preschool. She just got off. She's watching right now. So hey, how you doing, Lauren, Lily? But yeah, it's been an amazing journey. Like you said, I left my career maybe about 4 or 5 years ago to start my farm. And, I always tell people I left my career to start my farm. And that's like the romantic story. Mm-hmm. And that's like what I tell people. But the reality is...
That's what they hear, but they don't hear all the hard work behind that, right?
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Yeah, the reality is that when you quit your career to follow your dreams, you end up just getting less appealing job to pay the bills. So actually I just got off work at like 6 a.m. and went to bed at 7:30 a.m. I woke up at like 10 to get ready to come here. It's like 1:30 now, so I'm operating on 3 hours of sleep. So if I doze off in the middle of this, I apologize.
Hopefully we don't get too boring.
It's a grind. So right now I'm my wife is like, make sure you talk about this because it's very, I try to be as transparent as possible. Mm-hmm. Yes, it's romantic to say that I quit my job just to start my farm and chase my dreams. But yeah, I in order to pay the bills, I ended up getting a job. I work in a plant now, which is a very different experience for me just because I graduated from college. I worked in the office. 9 to 5, and I did nonprofit management and kind of working with underserved populations.
Everything.
Yeah, and so in those jobs, like what I realized was that I never took any time for myself. I was trying to climb the ladder. I worked 9 to 5 in the office in the evenings. I'd be checking emails, taking phone calls on the weekends. I'm doing programming, I never turned off. I just realized at some point I got burnt out. I went into some dark places. Mm-hmm. I developed like a bad alcohol problem. I ultimately decided that I wasn't happy in those situations. And so I left that to start the farm, and then I ended up getting another job, which is really cool too, because like now I'm working in a plant. Mm-hmm. And the two dynamic is very interesting because like you realize like, you know, when you come from an office setting, you have this idea of what maybe a plant worker is. Mm-hmm. But when I was working in the office, I tied a lot of my self-value and my self-worth into the work that I did. And then at some point I realized I just didn't care about that.
Yeah.
And then when I went and worked in a plant, I was able to just punch in and out. My mind, all my creative juices, all my creative energy, I was able to focus that on my wife, my children, and my farm now. So it was like very liberating in a sense.
Yeah.
And you know, it was very motivating too to go and work in a plant like that, because you realize those guys just punch in and out. And they don't tie they're not trying to climb the ladder. So their happy place is what they do at home, the time they spend with their family. And for me, like, I never understood that, because I was always like very career driven. And so I was trying to climb the ladder, and then I realized I just wasn't happy. And so this whole journey has been very like eye-opening for me.
It is, yeah. And like you said, going back to like working with all these, your colleagues at the plant, I mean, you know, they're happy where they are. And, you know, one person, they asked me, they're like, "My, what is success?"
Yeah.
Right? Like, "Oh, like, you're successful, right?" Well, I can't really say I'm successful, because everybody's definition of success is different.
Yeah.
My definition of success might be different from yours. Mm-hmm. I'll achieve my success.
Yes.
But your definition of success is different, right? Mm-hmm. So, I mean, whatever everybody's definition of success is, I think that, you know, that's what makes them happy.
Yeah.
And, you know, like you said, you know, just being surrounded by people that they're happy with, you know, things that they have, mm-hmm. is also, like, just, you know, amazing, too. And, you know, like I said, one thing I say, too, is I appreciate everybody's hustle.
Yeah.
You know, I appreciate your hustle. I mean, your hustle is you're grinding all night.
Yeah.
You come home, you're running your farm, right? You know, and it's like, and I value that. I see so much value in, you know, people's hustle. And, you know, that's for me, it's like, I want to support that.
Thank you. Yeah. Yeah. And I think the work that you do here is great, too, because, like, and like you said, I have my own show. And selfishly, like, you know, it's just, I use it as a platform to kind of just advertise what I do on the farm, and then also to talk to like very interesting people and to kind of share their stories. You know, some of my favorite conversations are, I've brought on my siblings, and you know, to have a 3-hour conversation about them, to kind of really pick their brains, has been very kind of healing in a sense.
Yeah.
You know, I think we all grew up so traumatically, and we never really took the time to really talk to each other and ask each other how they experienced their childhood. And so to be able to do that was very, like, very healing for me.
Yeah.
And it was very cool. So I look forward to bringing the rest of my siblings on too, to just to kind of pick their brains. And then also, like, what I realized is, since I've developed like this small platform, you know, it's nothing like this, but like, if
you
I can
have a great platform too.
Yeah. If I can shine the spotlight on the people that I love, and the people that have done right by me, and the people that have always supported me, like, I'm happy to do that. Yeah.
Yeah. And you know, one thing that someone else said to me last week made me, you know, thought about life a little bit. And he said, even an ant can tip a scale.
Yes.
Right. And because what he said to me, he was like, "Hey, Mai, why don't you do this?" I'm like, you know, I'm just one person. I can't make a difference.
Yeah.
Right. And he's like, "Mai, one ant can tip the scale." I'm like, "Oh, yeah, that's absolutely right."
Yeah.
You know, if you think about life, you know, even one kawaii-hama-mesana, that makes a whole difference to someone's life. And, you know, with you just having those small, genuine conversations with your family, things that you guys don't have time because you're busy with your life and they're busy with theirs. And to sit down and have these small, organic conversations, I think it's very humbling in a way.
Yeah. And to, like, just add on to that analogy, I think what the ant is, like, you know, and tipping the scale, like, when I left the farm, I think I initially left, or when I left my career to start my farm, what I thought was a very selfish endeavor, because I said, I'm going to stop doing all this community work, and I'm just going to take care of me and my family. But I realized, like, in the process of taking care of myself, taking care of my family, I'm actually doing more work for the community.
Mm-hmm.
You know, with starting the farm, like, I realized, like, as a young farmer, a young monk farmer, I'm, like, kind of, you know, I'm kind of creating a path for other young farmers to, I guess, or young people to, like, leave their careers and kind of do, you know, seek out whatever makes them happy. And then, Yeah, so I mean a little bit about the farm, but yeah, we have a small farm.
So we haven't really talked about your name, right?
Yes. Oh yeah. I'm so sorry. I just get into it.
So Griller Pastures.
Yes.
So how did you? I'm thinking, you're a honey farm.
Yes.
You farm bees.
Yes.
So how did you come up Griller Pastures? Like how?
Yep. So Griller Pastures, that came from guerrilla gardening. Yeah. So if you're familiar, if you guys aren't familiar with guerrilla gardening, it's this idea of growing food and you with unconventional methods, mm-hmm. In unconventional spaces. So it's our goal to establish our home base out there in the country on the farm, and then at some point to come back into the city and teach people how to grow food in their city lot, right? And so guerrilla gardening is this idea that you grow food in urban lots, grow food on sidewalks, right? And you feed the community with it. And I wanted to incorporate that in what I do and add an animal side to it. And my goal in 10 years is to be able to teach classes for people to how to grow food and within their city lot. And teach them how to do a small scale down version of what we do on the farm. So that's 10 years in the work.
That'd be great, because if you tell me mine, go grow some tomatoes, I would not even know where to start.
Yeah, yeah.
Give me some seeds and I'll put it in and I'll just water every single day.
Yeah, and you know what? That's essentially what it is. That's essentially, when you break it down, that's what it is. It's trial and error. Mm-hmm. You just got to go out there and do it.
Yeah, and I think that skills that like our mom and pop, they learned that and they grew up harvesting their own crops. And
yes.
But for us, you know, we grew up in a generation where we just run to the store.
Yep.
You know, everything's genetically modified.
Yes.
Right? And then nothing's organic anymore unless you buy organic food. But, just growing your own stuff, eventually it comes back down to our kids' generation. Will they have the skills for that?
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, we talked a little bit off air, but I actually learned how to garden from my mother. My mother, may she rest in peace. She passed away about this time last year.
Sorry to hear that.
Yeah, but she taught me how to garden. At the time, I hated every second of it. She would take me outside. She would yell at me. She would go, "Hey, do this, do this." She made me till up the whole yard, you know, and she had multiple sclerosis, so she couldn't do any of it herself, so she was on a wheelchair. And so I grew up gardening with her, and then eventually, when I got my own place in my mid-20s, I realized, oh, this is peaceful.
Yeah.
This was what my mom meant to say. And, you know, she taught me so much about life and what it meant to be Hmong, by way of gardening.
Yeah.
I've had some really cool opportunities to kind of speak on Hmong gardening at this couple months ago, I was invited out to PBS Wisconsin Lawn and Garden Show to kind of speak on the Hmong people and our the role we play in localized food, in the localized food economy, in the farmers market and stuff. So I got to kind of speak a little bit about our journey and a little bit about what we do. And, I just realized that we come from a long generation and long line of farmers. Mm-hmm. We're the first generation that aren't gardeners, that didn't have to grow food, you know, for themselves. So if we stop gardening today, essentially we'll be ending a long tradition of gardening.
Exactly.
And so I want to make sure I keep that going. And on the farm, it's very special because I get to take my daughter out every day. We go and pick eggs.
Yeah.
We go to the garden. We go and play with the bees. We chase the goats around.
I love that.
So she gets to see all that. And nothing makes me feel more Hmong than when I'm outside working in the sun, working with my animals.
Yeah.
So
I love that. I love how your mom planted that seed with you, because what I say is in business, we call it planting the seed, right? Yeah. And your mom, she planted that seed with you. And here you are planting that seed to your kids.
Yeah, exactly.
So one day they're going to pass it on to their kids.
Yeah. And I hope they do. And even if they don't, you know, I won't be upset. I wanted to lay down great foundation for them, let them know that they're loved, and let them know that whatever path that they take, that I'm going to support them. And they're a big reason. When I left my career, you know, I had my first daughter already at the time. And essentially what it came down to was how can I tell my daughter to chase her dreams? How can I tell her do what makes her happy if I'm not doing that. If I'm stuck at this miserable job doing something that I don't love, right, and overworking myself, how can I tell her to go chase her dreams? And essentially, you know, so she was a big, big reason why I left my career. And so I've been very blessed. Yeah. And so.
And you feel good about leaving career to start your bee farm?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, there's still, you know, there's not a day that goes past. You know, I'd be lying if I, you know, I don't regret it.
Yeah.
But I do acknowledge that this was something I wanted to do, and that I'm taking a big gamble and a big risk in starting my own business. And that I'm taking my family along for the journey. At any point, this can flop. And then I just leave my kids and my wife in a bad spot, you know, where now we're all like, now we're like hugely in debt, you know, and so, but you know.
But you know, like they say, no risk, no rewards.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And I told my wife, you know, we talked about it and she understood my situation and where I was at. And she said, you know, she gave me 5 years. So here I am, year three.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, fortunately for me, I went to college, graduated from college, and, you know, I was able to find some success in the corporate world. So I can always return to that if all else fails. Yeah. But I think I'm all in.
Yeah. I see that you have a lot of good success in your gorilla farming too, because, I mean, you do bee farming, you do a lot of your educational stuff. Mm-hmm. You allow field trips, right? In the future, you're looking about bringing field trips to your farm.
Yep.
So you can provide education to our kids.
Yep.
You know, on top of that, you do a lot of other stuff. And we have products here. Do you want to share with us what some of the products that you have?
Yeah, so on the farm, like, you know, I realized that, you know, in my first years, I tried to do pastured poultry, try to raise meat birds, try to raise eggs, and try to do a vegetable garden. But what I realized was I'm not going to outgrow vegetables than our parents. Mm-hmm. Who's been doing it for 50 years,
mm-hmm.
you know,
and
for their whole lives.
Acreages.
Yeah, so I wasn't gonna be able to outproduce them or outproduce any of the people producing meat. And so I had to find my own niche, and you know, we were keeping bees at the time, and you know, I think that sparked a lot of interest. Mm-hmm. And so our niche is the bees. So here we have like our honey that we've harvested actually from our own hives. Mm-hmm. And then we have a ton of skincare products.
Some?
Yeah, absolutely. So this is the sample here.
Oh, that's
Okay. So if you just give me your finger,
this is organic that you collect from a beehive.
Yes. Yeah. So let me know how that tastes. It's great with tea. It's great with coffee.
It's really good.
A toast.
Yeah.
And so we've been very blessed with this opportunity, and so. And then we also make lip balm, hand balms, and then a dog balm, and we make that all from the beeswax that we melt from our hives. And the lip balm, so that is a dog balm.
Oh.
And then we also have our hand balm here, so you can get that a shot there.
What's a dog balm?
Dog balm is you would put that on your dog's paws,
on their
nose to protect, essentially to protect them from like the weather, protect them from the ice and the salt, especially here in the wintertime. Mm-hmm. But this is our hand balm here, and that's our lavender scent.
Oh.
And so
it's kind of like hand lotion?
Yep. Yep.
Nice.
Yeah, so it
smells really good too.
Yeah, and it's like a thicker paste, and then the...
I love that.
Yeah, the beeswax traps the moisture in there, and it makes, you know, it feels really good. So I use it every day, and then we have a dog on the farm. Who protects our chickens and our animals.
Mm-hmm.
And so I use my paw balm for my animals, especially, you know, because he's outside. He's doing all the hard work protecting my animals, like in the cold winter. And so I got to make sure I take good care of him.
Yeah.
And we also
have some that are unscented for people that are maybe hyper allergic to a scent or something, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yep. And then these things are great just because, like, what I realize is, like, farming is very seasonal. Mm-hmm. And so the lip balm, you know, I can only the bees can only produce so much honey, and I can only sell so much honey, right? But the lip balm and the hand balms, that's what really keeps us alive, especially in the wintertime, because farming is so seasonal. So lip balm, you know, that doesn't go bad, and the hand balm, you know, that, you know, And everybody, especially here in Minnesota, can use some.
Yeah, so. Especially like during the winter when it's so dry.
Yeah.
Yeah. So these are all organically made?
Yep. We make everything in-house. And, you know, it's actually, it's really funny like how we came up with the idea. You know, we started harvesting honey and we realized we just have a ton of beeswax that I had no clue what to do with.
Yeah.
I actually saw a video on TikTok of them making lip balms. Mm-hmm. And I was like, oh, I have beeswax.
Yeah.
I can do this. And then, so we started making that and last year, and then I realized, oh, this is kind of unique and this is a cool niche. And this is a way that I can kind of separate myself from a lot of the other more traditional farmers. And so we created a website and, you know, I learned how to do that through YouTube. I actually learned how to keep bees through YouTube, you know, and so, we created a website, created an online store, and then through social media, like marketing, like we were able to kind of build a small following, and we've had some small successes, and we're trying to break into, you know, the goal is to eventually get into like a local store,
yeah,
like Target or something like that. And so, yeah, if anybody has a hookup to like a local store, definitely like hit me up.
I would love to see that. So where can we find this online? What's your website?
Yeah, so my website is gorillapastures.com and it's gorillas with two R's and two L's. Okay. So gorilla, not like the monkey, but like guerrilla warfare.
Okay.
And so gorillapastures.com. We also do a lot of like pop-ups. We'll be at the Hmong Arts and Craft Fair coming up here in May, and so we try to do as many pop-ups, and so if you just follow us up on Facebook and Instagram, we try to post wherever we're going to be, and so, and I love meeting people, and I love interacting with people, and one of my goals for this summer is to eventually do the Hmongtown Outdoor Market, and almost, but, you know, want to sell product, and then also to connect with the community about our history with beekeeping and honey and beeswax, because since I've started this, I've had a lot of crazy inquiries from like aunties about wanting beeswax, you know, wanting some of the larvae, you know, and
what do they do with it though?
I don't know, and that's why like I would love to go to a Hmongtown market and just to kind of speak to maybe our history with this, like.
Yeah.
I don't know if we were beekeeping at some point. I know the wax is sometimes used in our tapestry to make clothing and to dye clothing for, with certain patterns. So I would love to just kind of dive into kind of our historical use of this. So if anybody has a way that I can get into the Hmongtown market, that'd be amazing too. Because I would love to connect with the elder. Oh, that's why I'm here. Yeah.
Yeah. I love connecting people. So yeah, for sure.
And so, yeah. And like, I love talking to the elders about it. And like I said, they've had some crazy inquiries. And so I just want to make sure I can meet the demand and, see what the market needs.
Yeah.
And again, this is kind of how we set ourselves apart from, a lot of the more traditional farmers, because like I said, I think all these people are doing great work, and you know, rather than competing with them, we're taking market share away from them.
And you're doing something completely different. I mean, something that which the pawe mo oni na.
Yeah.
I've never seen. I mean, which is amazing. Mika like, wow, y'all, this is my bee farm. Like, how do you contain those bees? Where do you get all those bees?
Yeah. So.
Sure.
Yeah. Yeah. So beekeeping was something I've always wanted to do as a young person, and then once I got the farm, I was just like, I've always watched YouTube videos, and then, you know, I just ordered some bees. So you can order your bees in like in two separate ways. It's a bee package where they just come in like with a box of like 3,000 bees, and you just put them into your hives, and it comes with the queen. Or you can buy like a bee nook, and that comes with like a established bee colony already, and then you just put those frames into your hives. So that's usually what I get, and then I get all my bees from Ames Farms, who is actually served as a mentor of mine's, who's been very great, Brian and those guys and Mark over at Ames Farms, because I wouldn't be here without them, because when they found out that I've never taken a bee class, you know, I've been doing all this stuff myself, they were like, hey, why don't you come out, spend some time with us, and we'll actually show you how to do this, and we'll help you kind of get things squared away. And so shout out to Ames Farms and mm-hmm. Brian and Mark. But yeah, you know, you realize on this journey is like, you need people.
Mm-hmm.
And
absolutely,
the people that have reached out and supported me, like, I'm eternally grateful for. And that's why I want to make sure I do the same for whether you're a young farmer, whether you're a young person, you know, questioning what your role in life, yeah. right? And so, we also do a lot of educational programs in schools. So we take our bees inside like a little glass observation box, and we take them to like kids programs. We talk and we'll show them like what the queen bee looks like. We'll show them like the different stages of development of a bee. We also take our goats and our chickens. And so we also provide those services for like schools and youth programs. And that can range anywhere from like kids in elementary school or like college level kids. You know, for elementary school students, it becomes a petting zoo. Mm-hmm. They just want to touch the animals. They want to pet the baby goats. They yeah. want to hold the chickens. And it's super fun and super mm-hmm. cute. And then for like our college students, it's more about sharing my story and about leaving my career and starting this. And so it's more about my mental health journey. And so we cater our educational program to the needs of, you know, the students. And you know, we've been finding a lot of success in that too. And we've partnered up with the City of Brooklyn Park. We've worked with Right Path of Miracles, the kids over at Warman Muay Thai. We're trying to do a program at Cypherside. And then hopefully the goal is to eventually set up beehives inside of schools or on top of schools.
Oh.
And then be able to take some of the students up and put them in bee suits and actually take them, have them work with the bees themselves, have them harvest their own honey to sell for themselves. So lots of fun things in the works, but everything takes capital and everything takes time. That's why I'm here today.
Yeah. You know. And I love your story serves as an inspirational testimony that, you know, you don't ever feel stuck.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, if, like for you, you went to school to start your career and you know what, I want to follow my dreams. And
yeah.
for you, it just serves like an inspirational testimony that, hey, if I can do it, you can
yeah.
do it too.
Yeah.
You know, don't ever feel stuck, and you can always change, and it's okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
Yeah, because I was late. I was like 29,
mm-hmm.
which isn't old, but it's also not young either. And you know, I was working in my field for 8-9 years, and I realized I was just burnt out.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I always say too, like, I think people in my generation, young people, sometimes. We do tasks and we do these things for other people and we don't exactly know why,
mm-hmm.
right? We go to college because our parents want us to.
Mm-hmm.
We end up getting degrees and we get these jobs and then we end up realizing, is this what I wanted to do?
Yeah.
Do I even like this?
Was I following my dreams or my parents'
yeah,
dreams?
Yeah,
right?
Exactly. And then so when I got there and, you know, of course, my mother was super happy and very proud of me when I was doing that. But I think she was happy to another level when I left that and when I started the farm and I told and I explained to her that, hey, I'm not happy what I'm doing. She was very understanding that. And what I'm realizing now, especially as a parent now, like, I think our parents just want the best for us. And I think they forced us into these situations because they didn't essentially know how to navigate the system and they just wanted the best for us and they just wanted us to set us up to do well in life.
Mm-hmm.
And so when I told her and I was able to explain to her and articulate that, hey, like, this is, and you know, it also helped that I was gardening.
Yeah.
So I could be like, hey mom, like you, this is your thing. You showed me this. So she was like, extremely pleased. Yeah. Yeah. And so she was very, very pleased with that. And, yeah, before she passed, she got to come out to the farm. I think she was very, very happy.
Yeah, I think she'll be really proud of you today.
I hope so. One day I will get to talk to her, and then I can show her all of this stuff. Yeah, and one of the unique things is I get to honor her.
Mm-hmm.
by coming out here and telling her story, you know, being invited out to like do public speaking events and kind of share her journey here in America. So I think that's, you know, it's been a real blessing.
Yeah. And I love seeing other people chase their dreams, whether it's doing something they absolutely love or just doing something they're passionate about. And I just love hearing about these kind of stories.
Yeah.
So with the bee, when you are harvesting the bees, like how do you transform it from a wax to like a honey, right? Or
So at first, I should have brought frames with me.
Essentially
you would pull the frames. The frames are kind of mixed with bee larvae and honey. You have to make sure you find frames that are just all honey because you don't want to disturb the life cycle of the bees. And you also want to make sure there's enough honey for them to survive. And so you take the honey, you put it in the bee frames, and you put it in a spinner. And then that'll spin off all the honey from it. And then from there, you would take that wax, melt that down, and then we'd combine that with various oils to make a lot of our products here today. Yeah, so it's like a whole process. So if you check out like my Instagram and my Facebook, I try to show that process. And again, I try to be as transparent as possible, with life on the farm.
So for a bottle like this, how many of those boards does it fill?
So one of those frames can be like 2 to 4 pounds of honey.
Wow.
So it's actually
that's a lot of honey.
Quite a bit of honey, yeah. So the bees are super busy. They are the superstars, so it's just about taking care of the bees, and they're going to do the work. And then it's about making sure you take enough, and then also making sure you leave enough for them to continue to thrive, because they need to make sure that they're taken care of too. I've been beekeeping for 3 years now. I didn't even harvest honey for my first 2 years because I wasn't sure how much I can harvest. And then eventually this past year, you know, I scaled up my hives, and then, I was able to, I actually knew what I was doing a little bit more. And so I felt a lot more comfortable harvesting some honey. So this year, this is actually our honey from last year's harvest, and it's actually a really unique process because you can see like there's almost different colors and different levels of transparency, whether or not how runny it is, and it kind of depends what flowers are in bloom when you harvest.
And these are like raw honey
straight from the hive. Okay. And you know, the very experienced beekeepers, what they can do, or what they're really good at, is they can time their harvest with whatever's flowers are in bloom.
I've never thought about that.
Yeah, and so, but those guys are really big, and they're harvesting every week. So when dandelions are in blooms, they'll harvest that, and they'll call it dandelion flowers. So I just call mine the wildflower honey, just because like I'm not there yet.
Yeah,
that is the goal, but you know, maybe one day, and you know, with the help of the community, maybe one day we can continue to do that.
Yeah, you know, growing up, when I think about honey, I just think about like eating the honeycomb.
Yeah.
You know, like the raw honeycomb.
Yes.
And I think I was at the farmer's market a couple of years ago. They actually sold raw honeycomb.
Yeah, yep.
And so, very weird texture because you have that wax that's still in there. But,
so that, we actually, we got a little bit of that last year, but it's a little bit different setup. So we didn't get a lot of it. But I had a lot of inquiries about stuff like that. So we actually sold a little bit of those. So where we had the honeycombs, and we would cut them out into little blocks and we'd sell them. And a lot of the other countries, that's actually how they consume honey. So then when I talk to people from my parents' generations, that's how they're more familiar with that type of honey. So then that's why the goal this summer is to harvest honey in that way.
Yeah, I would love to try some when you have that.
I'll stop
by your farm.
Yeah, we sold out of it. Yeah, the best way is just to pull it out of the hive and just take a bite out of it. And, you know, hopefully you don't bite into a bee.
Yeah.
Yeah, they wouldn't be too happy. But, it's tons of fun. And, Yeah, and so it's like a really interesting thing because only here in the West do we know honey in its liquid form. Just because it takes a lot of work to separate the wax and the liquid honey. And so in a lot of places where they don't raise bees and they just harvest wild honey from nature, right? They eat honey in the with the wax.
Wow.
So then they end up just chewing the wax like bubblegum. So it's like a really interesting concept.
Yeah.
And I think it's like a newer thing, like it's like a newer trend in the beekeeping world too, just because like as we here in America become more like diverse, and we're starting to serve maybe a less than traditional population, and we're serving communities from all corners of the world, they don't know honey in this in this form. So yeah. They've never consumed honey in this form. They've only ever consumed honey in the combs. So that's something we're gonna work on this summer, and it takes it's a little different setup. And so we're getting things ready to go for that.
Is your farm open for a few trips or in the future for guests to come?
Yeah, so right now we're not quite open yet. I have to say, because we're just starting our journey. It's less of a farm and it's more of a house in the woods, you know? And this is also a place of residence. Mm-hmm. And so we're trying to set this up, and hopefully in the future we can host classrooms and field trips, but that requires building a barn, that requires having a separate bathroom other than ourselves. Right now we do I have friends and small, really small groups. You know, I've had a couple families come up that were interested, but it is difficult just because it is our place of residence too. There was a moment where we used to sell eggs, and legally you can only sell eggs on your property, right? And so we had all these people coming up to the farm, and eventually my wife goes, "No, I don't know if I'm okay with that. I don't know if I'm okay with having all these changes." And I was like, "Well, yeah, that's probably a good point."
I respect that.
Yeah, and so so we're not doing too much of that yet, and we're slowly building to that point.
Okay.
And so right now, what we do as a service is we do these educational programs where we go into the schools and we bring our animals over there. But the goal is to be able to have field trips on site, have bees on site too at schools to do work here in the city and work on the farm. But that's a little ways from now. You know, we're working. We applied for some grants, and hopefully we can make that happen in the next couple of years. But that is a goal of mine.
I do hope you achieve your goal.
Yeah, it's
Where do you see yourself in 10 years from now?
In 10 years, I hopefully would be doing this full time.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of these things just take a lot of time and it takes a lot of work. And so right now, between working overnights, balancing fatherhood, balancing being a husband, my wife is in grad school right now. She's finishing up her last year, so she's going to be re-entering the workforce. It's about keeping the family unit together right now. That's my main goal. And then hopefully in the future I can leave my career and do this full time. So in 5 years I want to be doing this full time. Hopefully I have my barn on site. We can be doing educational classes on the farm. We can also be doing youth programs here in the cities, partnering up with schools, and then maybe hopefully even have property here in the city where we can have a small urban farm here.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm not gonna stop until we have a horse stable.
Okay.
Inside Minneapolis or St. Paul.
Yeah.
And we're teaching kids how to ride horses up and down the block, you know. Mm-hmm. And then also keeping bees and keeping mm-hmm. animals. So I grew up here in the city, and access to food was always mm-hmm. tough. And so that's why gardening was always big for me and my mother. You know, food stamps could only cover so much food, but whatever vegetables we can grow in our yard, we did as much of that as possible. So I want to be able to continue that and teach other people how to grow food. Mm-hmm. That's why it's important for me.
Yeah, I love that. And passing it on to your kids, Charlotte. Yeah. So back to your podcast.
Yeah.
Because you're a co-host too.
Yeah, so, yeah.
Share with me a little bit more about No Eggs Podcast. How did you guys start it? How did you come up with the name No Eggs Podcast?
Yeah, so it's a Hmong's mental health podcast. We that's our primary focus. As far as the name goes, our original name is, or our name is actually the Nongkei Podcast. I hope I can say that here
on air.
It's
fine.
But it's the Nongkei Podcast because, you know, it's men's health, you know, so it just kind of makes sense. And it's kind of funny where we want it to be lighthearted at the same time, talk about, you know, very serious topics, but we want to cover it from kind of a lighthearted approach. I think there's a lot of people doing great work having these more serious conversations, and also me and Two are not like, this isn't our profession. Mm-hmm. We're not specialists in it, so if we say something wrong, we can always go back to, oh, we're just we're the No Bay Podcast, we're just two idiots talking about whatever. But yeah, we've started about a year ago. We've been very fortunate to have the guests that we have. I think we just essentially, I'd like to think that we create a fun environment for our guests and we're very welcoming. We don't ever try to do like a gotcha with our guests. We don't try to surprise our guests or anything. We just try to keep everything lighthearted and fun. We like to promote other small business owners, what people are doing, unique things in the community. You know, we had like Pahua Her early on. She was like an amazing guest. We had Chef Yia on as a guest. Chinu Her came on as a guest. Mm-hmm. And for us, that was like crazy because that was like really early on.
You got Chinu on your show?
Yeah, we had Chinu on. And he came on. And how cool
is that? I must have missed that one.
How cool is that guy? Yeah, he was like one of our earlier episodes. Like amazing. And I found out, we went to church together, you know, and, you know, we knew a lot of the similar kids. We were like the exact same age. And so he's an amazing guy, and we've been so fortunate to have these on. And we bring on young artists that are doing like very cool and unique things in the community. And so, yeah, our guests range from just our friends and family to people doing, you know, Yia's got a TV show.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and at some point hopefully we could bring you guys on and kind of share your story. And so it's been a fun journey.
Yeah.
And you know, one of my guests, Nikita, shout out to her, she's an amazing guest. She brought on and she asked us, she brought up a really good point about us being a male platform and why we would have female guests on. And I guess I never thought about that, but you know, if we're I told her, I was like, if we're a men's health podcast, it makes sense that we bring on females too, right? Because we interact with women every day in our lives. There are significant others, there are sisters, our daughters, our aunties, our mothers. So it's like, it's great to have dialogue between us too. And, you know, one of the things she brought up was that usually male platforms stay exclusively male, and then female platforms stay exclusively female. That wasn't a goal for us, and I think it just made sense for us to have these dialogue with successful women that are doing great things too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's important to keep the balance.
Yeah.
Having like, even, you know, like we talked to, women have their own platform.
Yeah.
They have their own support group.
Yeah.
Men, they have their own support group, which is fine. At the end of the day, you know, they need each other to kind of balance.
Yeah,
and,
exactly.
You know, with your show, yeah, I mean, you guys have a platform for male, but at the same time, you bring on female guests so that you can keep the balance. And, you know, so, I mean, I see that.
Yeah. And it's great to hear them out, to hear their story. And, you know, it really set in stone, like it really made me understand some of the challenges that they have. Because, you know, anytime we have a female guest on, the comments are crazy.
Yeah.
You know, some of the comments get crazy.
What are some of the comments?
I don't know.
Can we say it?
it's her story to share, but we brought on Nikita. She She's doing...
I didn't pay attention to any of the comments, but...
Yeah, it's almost better if you don't.
Okay.
But yeah, she teaches a dance class for Hmong women, and it's called Heel and Heels. And it's a heel-style dance, which is maybe they're dressed a little bit more like sexier,
revealing.
Yeah. Okay. And so I think one of the cool things about her was like she's teaching women, Hmong women of all generations, how to feel sexy in their skin, how to feel good, and some of the, you know, she's had really positive feedback from like women that has taken her class, and so but then you get some of the crazy comments about, you know, coming from maybe a more traditional thought process. And, you know, but that's fine too, because we want to challenge people's way of thought, right? Yeah. That's why we brought her on, was that, hey, I think you're doing something very unique. And I think when we get these challenges in our comments, it just means that there's more work to be done. Mm-hmm. There's more dialogue that needs to happen between men and women.
Yeah.
But I don't want to get too deep into it because it's her story to share, and I don't think I'd be doing it any justice.
Doing a podcast like you, do you think that there's kind of some deficiencies and maybe male perspective versus a female perspective, or maybe some work that needs to be done? Because I feel that sometimes men think that they can't understand women.
Yeah.
Women feel the same way, right? So yeah. What do you think?
I think absolutely. And I think that's why we bring them on, because one, we need to hear them out. Mm-hmm. And then two, I think it'd be great if they heard us out too.
Yeah.
Because there is this, sometimes there is this idea of what Hmong men are.
Mm-hmm.
Right, and sometimes it's great to come on and kind of share our story a little bit, and maybe break down some of those barriers too for ourselves. And then it's also great to hear their stories. So then the more dialogue we have, I think the better.
Yeah.
You know, we hear each other's challenges, and we can hear how we can best support each other.
Mm-hmm.
You know, me and two, we, you know, and. We're both married, we're both older individuals, business owners, our wives are highly successful in their own fields, they have their own autonomy, they have their own dreams and their own paths, and we actually had a guest on, and she had mentioned that there is this trend where I think Hmong men are almost... There's a fear of Hmong women doing well and leaving Hmong men behind.
I saw that episode. I was actually just going to ask you about that one.
Yeah, yeah. And I think that's, you know, I think that's...
I don't think it has to do with race, though.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't think so.
That's across all genders. That's across all race.
Yeah.
And I think what I would say is, like, I think when you actually get into it, you realize that if your wife is operating at a high level, she's just as motivated as you, it adds to your quality of life.
Mm-hmm.
I think my wife is very supportive of my journey because she understands it, because she's driven as well too.
Yeah.
And that we shouldn't be afraid of somebody being driven.
Yes.
And I think we should seek out a partner that can kind of match our level. If I'm not as driven, if I have a partner that isn't also, like, that's okay too. Or if they are, like, I think we shouldn't be afraid of that. And I think we should.
I think it comes down to the compatibility and then also the energy level.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, like back to what you said, if I have a partner that is just as driven, has the same energy, has the same goals as I do, we share the same goals. Like, obviously, like, we will, our lives will drive together better, right?
Yeah.
Versus if I'm more driven and my partner is just more lax, and, you know, maybe eventually people's journeys fall apart, you know?
Yeah.
So I think, you know, I don't think that, you know, because I don't think it really matters to all the you know, when I, because I heard that podcast.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
I mean, because my husband, he's white, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So, and I'm just like, you know, I don't think, I mean, I haven't answered that. I'm like, I don't think that's the reason. The reason isn't because they're Hmong men or, you know, because marrying a white man or whatever. Mm-hmm. It's just, it comes down to compatibility.
Exactly.
And I think there's good in everything. There's good in Hmong man, there's good in white man, and there's bad in everything too.
Yeah. You know? So, 100%. Yeah. I think, and then we had another guest who won, shout out Van, because his father was his African American, his mother was his Hmong, and you know, he's 30 years old now. He's 30 something now, and so they were together. His parents were together early on.
So he probably faced a lot more challenges than we all did today.
Yeah, if you think. We face a lot of backlash now. Can you imagine that 30 years ago?
Yeah.
Holy smokes. So, and he talked about his journey, and he talked about his experience growing up with his Hmong side, and then, you know, how Hmong kids didn't always want to play with him because he was mixed. And so, but, you know, he said that when he was younger, he was able to speak Hmong and understood everything that they were saying and how it made him feel. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, just touching on this idea of what Hmong is, and I think we have there's Hmong people doing so many different great things, mm-hmm. and, you know, it's hard to define or box what mm-hmm. Hmong is now. Mm-hmm. You know, we have Hmong people in different walks of life, you know, farmers, business entrepreneurs, you know, people just doing all great things, and I think it's hard to define what it is, you know. Again, it's his story to share, but you know, my co-host, he spent most of his childhood in France in a small town where there was no Hmong kids, so he was the only Hmong kid. And when he came here, he didn't speak English and he spoke a little bit of Hmong and but primarily French. Mm-hmm. And he talked about his experience, and so I think, you know, we're international now, and I think this idea of what Hmong is, you know, I think we have to be a little bit more open-minded as to what that is now, and try to be inclusive.
I think everybody has, like you said, everybody has their own walks of life, everybody has their own struggles, and just try to be open-minded that, you know, everybody has their own struggles, and just being allowed to be open to see the differences and being okay with that. And I think that your podcast, holding that platform of sharing the deficiencies on each side, I think that really helped bridge the gap.
It's crazy to think that we have a platform, and it's crazy to see where it's become. Mm-hmm. Because originally, you know, we just kind of wanted to talk.
Have you ever thought about bringing men and women on and just having men and women discuss?
I think that's why we bring women on. I think we, I think we can speak to a kind of that male perspective pretty well. And so then I think, you know, to bring women on, I think that's why we wanted to bring them on, was to be able to have these dialogue. And so it's crazy to see where it's turned out to, because now it's kind of become, it's become work, and it's become this, you know, it's become this platform where we're having really important conversations. And I was like, oh, we didn't start that, you know, we just kind of wanted to, you know, talk about our journeys and share our experiences. And now it's kind of building and turned into this thing of, okay, now we're having these important conversations. We have to be careful what we're saying and what we're putting out there now.
Yeah. But they're important conversations, you know.
It needs to happen.
I think that, you know, there's a lot of work that need to be done. And I think that you guys have a great platform and sharing that and bringing people on with struggle things that they share, that, hey, maybe someone else is having the same struggles. And, you know, just had the ideologies.
And, you know, me and Tu, we don't always agree on everything. And same with the guests. Guests can come on with different ideologies. And, you know, but it's about having a conversation. It's about hearing each other out. Yeah. I think that's the most important thing. I think, you know, in today's world, I think it's become too divisive. I think people aren't listening, and I think people aren't empathizing with each other. We talk a lot about some of the cultures and traditions that we have. Like, I grew up, my father left when I was very young. Mm-hmm. So, because I grew up primarily with my mother, I didn't go to a lot of these Hmong events. Mm. Like, I attended my first Hmong event, like Hmong wedding that I went to was like in my 20s. Mm. You know, my brother got married, but I was still so young, so I didn't understand what, like, some of the nuances of what was going on. But like, I didn't like really go and attend some of these events till later on in my life. And so I'm not too familiar with all of these customs and traditions. Again, my father left when I was very young. I could have probably been more proactive to myself. And I probably could have done more to kind of learn some of these stuff. But I think people are, but I think there's a set of people in our culture and community that can also identify with that. Mm-hmm. Where they can go, I don't know exactly what's going on, but I'm trying to learn now in my 30s or,
and I think that back to it. That the what you're saying is what our kids' generation is going through right now.
Yeah,
too,
yeah.
You know, so
yeah, so yeah. It's important dialogue, so check it out. No Eggs Podcast. We're on Facebook, Instagram. All of our episodes are uploaded on YouTube. We're trying to figure out a way to get on Spotify and everything else too. If you guys are good with cameras and good with audio and stuff, we definitely need some help. It's just the two of us, and it's becoming more and more work. You know, we have these discussions all the time about it, where it's like, all right, because we always talked early on about this is just a fun passion project and we don't want this to become work, and now it's becoming work. And we're having these important conversations, and sometimes the camera isn't set up right or the audio isn't set up right, and so we're trying to work through all these little bumps. But it's been a fun process, and it's been very engaging, and it's been a healing process, because like I realized, like I get to talk a lot about things that I don't normally talk mm-hmm. about, and share like experiences that I normally wouldn't share mm-hmm. with other people. And it is crazy to be able to, the idea of like sharing it with a large audience.
Right, and I think that one thing that people forget is it's okay to be vulnerable.
Yeah.
You know, it's okay to share your vulnerable stories, and because you never know what that's going to impact.
Yeah.
So, and that's just, you know, some people, when they share vulnerable things, they feel like, oh, I don't want to come off vulnerable. I don't want people to see me that way. But it's, you know, there's nothing completely, absolutely nothing wrong with it.
Yeah.
You're sharing stories that, you know, for me, just listening from your stories that, hey, you know, your dad left you when you were a kid, and, you know, your struggles, you left your job to do this. And it's just like, those are amazing stories.
Yeah.
And that's something that can be inspiring to someone.
Yeah. I hope so. Yeah. I hope so. Yeah. It's been an incredible journey. Yeah, and then, we've like I said, we've been very blessed to get to the point that we are now, and we're realizing now that we have a responsibility. It's crazy to say, like, we have a responsibility to the community now, or to continue to have these engaging conversations. And I think people are kind of looking to us, and I've had a couple messages where people are like, "You should say this or do this," or it's tough because it's like, you know, like, I don't want to speak on things I don't know too much about at the same time, and I want to make sure I'm coming from an open mind.
Yeah, and you never know who you're gonna trigger either.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So it's just, I totally get what you're saying.
Yeah. So be nice to us in the comments, guys. Like, we're learning, and we're just trying to figure things out, and we're doing this for you guys. And then, support our small businesses, because, like, at the end of the day, this is all, the work that we do is all pro bono. It's a lot of work. We're putting out clips every day. We're putting out an episode every week. We missed this week because of some technical issues, but, you know, we'll be right back on it, so.
Yeah. You deserve a break.
Not much of a break, because I was like kind of having a meltdown at the beginning of the week, like, oh no, we missed an upload, you know, yada yada. But you know, it's just a part of the process, and it's part of the growth process. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just something I have to talk to my therapist about. That's the other thing too. Like, we talk a lot about therapy and kind of like how it's been. Kind of been helpful. Well, I'll speak about my experiences, but like, I've been going to therapy for about a year now, and it's been a really fun journey. It's been a very healing journey, and it's allowed me to help me deal and learn coping mechanisms to kind of not take too many things to heart and to help me kind of overcome some of the challenges. Like, I grew up a very emotional person. I wear my emotions on my sleeve. So I'm angry. I'm violently angry. But I am also violently sensitive. Mm-hmm. And so then it's helped me kind of deal with some of that more. And it's kind of, it's helped me process that. And, you know, it's something me and my wife has talked about for a long time. And, you know, she sees one too. And it's allowed us to kind of work on our relationships, allowed me to work on myself. And I think therapy is a great thing. I think everyone should at some point do it. And, you know, it's just, even if it's just like a check-in, like an annual check-in.
Yeah. I think everybody, every now and then, we all need a mental check.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Like for me, even I'm so busy, sometimes I need to be like, okay, you need to stop and have a mental check to make sure you're okay.
Yeah.
You know, because if you can't take care of yourself, you can't take care of anybody.
Yeah.
So sometimes every now and then I do need to like slow down and just take care of myself. So
yeah.
I think it's great that you're doing that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so we encourage that a lot on the podcast. And so,
yeah,
between the podcast, the farm, my current job, the family, it's go, go, go.
Yeah.
Like I said, I got off work early this morning. At 3 hours of sleep before I came here.
Oh, wow. I appreciate your hustle.
Huh? Oh, yeah. It's a grind. It's a grind. And it's all for my kids. And, you know, it's crazy because I started this journey to spend more time with my kids. And I'm realizing, in a way, I am spending more time with my children. And I am more involved just because my job doesn't take away from that. Mm-hmm. And in my small business now and in my podcast, like... Mm-hmm. My daughter gets to see all of that. She gets to see the grind. Mm-hmm. And so
what is a quote that you learned that's made change your life and you want to share with us?
Ooh, a quote. A lot of times we chase these high points in life. We're chasing these victories and we're chasing these big moments in our lives where we can celebrate wins in our lives. But what I'm realizing in life is that it's about surviving and not giving up at your lowest points, you know? And instead of chasing these high points, you know, it's just getting through a lot of these low points and knowing that there's an ebb and flow in this and you're gonna have good days and bad days. And it's just about not letting your bad days ruin, you know, or not crashing out or not burning out during your lowest times. So I forget what the exact quote is, but it was something along those lines of instead of chasing high points, just surviving those low points. Another quote I guess would I like to tell people is like, if what you're building only benefits yourself, then what you're building is not big enough.
Mm.
Right? If my farm only served to benefit me and my family, then essentially it's not big enough. That's why I wanted to make sure I do community work.
Mm.
Right? Make sure I continue teaching classes, going to these youth programs, the podcast. If I only go on and for myself and I only talk about myself, right? And I'm not giving people platforms to kind of share their stories, then it's not big enough.
Mm-hmm.
So what you're doing should also be elevating other people around you.
I love that.
Similar to what you're doing with this show and everything you're doing in real estate. Mm-hmm. So
yeah, I appreciate that. Yeah, no.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I thank you so much for coming in today, Ping.
Yes.
You shared amazing things, and I love hearing about your story. I hope that it serves a purpose, and I hope that it impacts someone else. That's watching. So, any last words before we go?
No, I just wanted to thank you for everything that that you do for the community, and thank you for having me on. And I think for the community, continue to be open-minded, give each other grace, give yourself grace too. Mm-hmm. And then, hey, man, if you know how I can put beehives in schools, or you know, hit me up, or if you want me to visit your classroom, let me know, and I'd love to come and talk a little bit about the work that I do and share my animals with the students.
Education is king.
Yes.
Well, thank you, Payne, for coming in today.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you. Well, families and friends, thank you for tuning in today with the episode with Gorilla Pastures. If you guys have not visited yet, visit them on Facebook, on Facebook/Gorilla Pastures, or visit their website, gorillapastures.com, if you want to order any of their products. Again, thank you guys for tuning in today. My name is Mai Miller. I'm a real estate broker, Diversified Realty. So if you guys have any real estate needs, I would love the opportunity to help you. We do commercial and residential. So otherwise, thanks for tuning in. I will see you guys next time.